joining us now live from Los Angeles, California, for TKO Studios, the CEO, Mr. Tze Chun, who has introduced a new model for comic book distribution. And if it goes well, and hopefully it will, this could be a paradigm shift for comics. Welcome to the program, sir.
Thank you very much for having me. I'm actually in Mammoth right now. Kids are going skiing today. So if you hear screaming in the background, that's what that is. And I'm actually the publisher and president of TKO Studios. Salvatore Simeone is our CEO.
Oh, okay. All right. I misread that in an article somewhere doing my research. So, and just incidentally, you are also a staff writer and a story editor on the current season of Gotham. Is that right? Got that right?
I am. That's right. I am a supervising producer on the current and writer of the current season of Gotham, which is our last season. We made it to 100 episodes, and it was really fun to be able to kind of tie off all those storylines.
Well, congratulations on that. I have been seeing some of your posts over on Instagram where you're showing the title sheets on scripts. It's been and that show has been such a crazy ride. Speaking of crazy rides. You're introducing a new idea in this new model for TKO that's sort of a mix between traditional practices and brand new procedures in terms of getting comic books out to the masses. Walk me through what you guys are doing and what's different about your model, and then how you came up with that.
You know, the company started a couple of years ago. It was the kind of brainchild of me and our CEO, Salvatore Simeone. Along with us, we had Cara, who's this Emmy winning producer who did a lot of our career outreach and creator relations. And then there's also Sebastian, who's our editor-in-chief. Now, we want to be the first modern comic book company. And to do that, we're doing things a little differently. First off, we are releasing our books. So every single one of our first four series, and we release them all at the same time. So you can read through a story from beginning to end without any interruption. We also are releasing our books in multiple formats. So from the second that those books dropped into the marketplace, we offered them as box sets, so a collector's box set with six issues and trade paperbacks, as well as digital. We felt that for a modern audience, they kind of like to read their books in whatever format they most enjoy. We provide that for our fans. The third thing we're doing is we are providing every issue free to read digitally off of our website, tkopresents.com. That was from the desire to just kind of let people know about our books, let them sample for free. And then maybe the most radical thing that we are doing is we are going outside of the traditional direct market distribution system. We are making deals with stores individually. We are not going through Diamond. The way that we have always done things is that we have not used middlemen. And, you know, we offer a great deal for individual comic book stores. For stores in the United States, we offer a 50% off cover price discount, a wholesale discount, and we pay for shipping. So we're seeing a lot of stores starting to stock our books. And for international, it's the same 50% discount, but we have to figure out shipping on a case-by-case basis.
Now, what was the thinking behind the decision to not go through Diamond? I mean, Diamond for the longest time has been the distribution model for everyone, and they essentially have pretty much a monopoly over the entire comic book distribution process. And over the years, we've heard every now and again some rumblings and some chatter, you know, just kind of under the surface that maybe there's another way to do it. And, you know, there's some frustration with Diamond. There's some frustration with some of the bigger publishers and some of, in how they're they're getting out variant covers and specials and new number ones and all of the, you know, we hear all of these complaints about all of this stuff. Was any of that factored into the decision to go the direct route rather than use Diamond, or was there other other reasoning behind that?
Well, I think for us, you know, we felt that we had the infrastructure to deal directly with stores and deal directly with our customers. And so Diamond to us felt kind of irrelevant. There were obviously the grumblings that we had heard about how stores felt about Diamond, but I understand why Diamond exists. I understand why stores want to order from them. You know, they make certain things simpler for them. But for us, again, it was came down to the choice that we have the infrastructure, so why would we give somebody a cut to do what we can do, I think, better ourselves? Our ordering system is super easy. You know, we launched about 5 weeks ago, and part of it is we've really put stores in control. They don't have to over-order. They can order as much as they think that they can sell. That 50% discount is if you buy one book or 1,000 books. And we have some stores that have ordered, you know, 2-3 times. They've been able to order the an amount that they felt they could safely sell. They don't have to put themselves at risk. Then they've sold out. Then they've ordered again. And then some of them have ordered a third time. So within 5 weeks, we're seeing multiple orders from a single store, and we're able to get the books back into the stores really quickly. And that's not something that we felt that we could do through Diamond.
Now, Peter Cimetti over at Alterna Comics has talked about his distribution model a little bit. He's also dealing directly with stores and such. Are you aware of his challenge to the other indie publishers to make all of the books returnable? Do you have that policy in place? What's it, if I read this book by Warren Ellis and you know, there's really not any question that I'm going to enjoy the book, but if there is that one outlier out there who doesn't enjoy the book and wants to send it back, what's your policy going to be on that kind of thing?
We've just never had that happen before. You know, for the stores themselves, I mean, that's just the truth. I mean, I think we deal with it on a case by case basis. If somebody truly said, like, I hate this book and I don't even want to see it in our living room, like, yeah, they should email us. You know, we would like to hear that feedback. But that's not something we've encountered. And, you know, part of the reason that we want to do things our way in terms of distributing to stores ourselves was so that we didn't essentially force stores to overorder. You know, they can be really conservative about their first order. What we've been finding is, you know, stores that are conservative about their first order, they're still selling out in 2-3 days. You know, part of being one of the first modern comic book companies is, you know, we really try to push people to stores that stock us on social media. So if somebody tweets out a photo of the books in the store, we immediately tell people, hey, if you're in the Brooklyn area or the Cincinnati area or wherever you are, Montreal area, we have books in, you know, in Paris and Rome. And we're just saying, yeah, if you're in that area, please visit that store, because we would love for you to support, you know, your local comic book store.
Now, speaking of reasons why people would like these books, you've loaded this first phase, as it were, with a lot of talent that, you know, a lot of these names are, you know, recognizable among comics fans. Take me through some of the titles that you've got here in this first wave of books, and then Maybe we'll talk about what's coming next.
In this first wave of books, we have Sarah by Garth Ennis, Steve Epting, and Elizabeth Brett Weiser. That is the story of Russian female snipers in World War II beating back the Nazi invaders on the Eastern Front. We also have a Western, which I wrote and was drawn by Artyom Trakhanov, a Russian artist. And it was colored by Julia Brusco, lettered by Jared K. Fletcher, and all of our titles by Sebastian Gruner. I should also say that Sarah was lettered by Rob Steen. He's an important part of that creative team. The Western Seven Deadly Sins is about a group of death row criminals who are recruited by a Mexican priest to return a Comanche war chief's daughter back to him in Comancheria. It's a Western, but we like to think of it as a Western that, like, you've never seen it before. We also have The Fearsome Dr. Fong, which is something that I co-wrote with my friend Mike Weiss. It was drawn by Dan McDade, and colored by Daniela Miwa. It was lettered by Steve Wands and edited by Sebastian Gerner. And that is a kind of tongue-in-cheek re-examination of like the Yellow Peril pulp novels of the 1920s, 1930s. And it's globe-trotting action-adventure. We like to think if you're a fan of Indiana Jones, you know, it's that type of kind of epic adventure. And then we have a book called Goodnight Paradise that is written by Joshua Dysart, Alberto Ponticelli, colored by Julia Brusco, and lettered by Steve Wands. And that is a murder mystery set in the homeless population in Venice, California, and downtown Los Angeles. You'll see that all of our books are kind of new takes on established genres. We don't do any superhero books. And this one is just very, to me, really special take on a mystery story with characters like you've never seen them before, all around kind of the homeless population in the city that I live in.
Now, you mentioned not doing any superhero stories. Is that something that we're deliberately going to avoid that category because there's oversaturation? Yeah. Or are there plans at some point maybe to get into capes a little bit as things progress?
I mean, listen, I love superhero comic books. That's what I grew up reading, and I still love, you know, I still love comic books that are about superheroes. But exactly, it's just the saturation. There's so many places that publish those types of books, and I think that audience is really well served for that particular genre. So it was a decision not to do superheroes.
Now, have you mentioned Elizabeth Breitweiser as part of the Sarah creative team, and not to get too deep into the weeds here, have you received any blowback or negative comments about her involvement with you know, all of the Comicsgate mess and all of this? Mm-hmm. Have you gotten any negative feedback at all for her being on a book?
Yeah, I mean, people have made comments on Twitter. People have, you know, certainly brought it up. We haven't done any conventions yet, so I'm sure that it will come up. But, you know, to me, when we were looking at who was right for the book, Elizabeth was perfect for the book. I had a conversation with her and Mitch. You know, I knew I did not, Comicsgate was not on my radar at that point. I knew that Mitch had posted some stuff about Trump, but I also didn't feel that it was my business to discriminate against somebody because of their political leanings. I don't think it's actually legal or moral for me to do so. I mean, Elizabeth has been a joy to work with. She's been extremely professional, and she's, you know, she's been great. So if we want to talk about Comicsgate, we can talk about Comicsgate, but you know, in this particular instance, you know, I understand the questioning about it. And obviously Comicsgate kind of came to a head deep into when the book was being produced.
And yeah, I think we can leave that conversation for another time. Okay. Now, the phase two books that are coming out, what's next for TKO?
Phase two is, we have a book by Jeff Lemire and Gabriel Walta called Sentient. That is the first ever Jeff Lemire-Gabriel Walta collaboration. There is a book with Roxane Gay and Ming Doyle, and Jordi Belair is doing the colors on that one. That is called The Banks. That is a story of three generations of women in Chicago who are master thieves, who have to work together to pull off their biggest score, which is also, you know, a deeply personal score. We have a book called Eve of Extinction that is written by Salvatore and Steven Simeone and drawn by Nick Varela and colored by Ruth Redmond. Ariana Maher is doing the letters for that. She's also doing the letters for The Banks. Eve of Extinction is about a virus that kind of turns men into monsters. And so it's a survival horror story. And in the fourth book, we have a book called Pound for Pound, which is a really fun kind of Tarantino-esque thriller about an MMA fighter who has to rescue her daughter from thugs on the Mexican-US border. That one is written by Natalie Chaidez. It is drawn by Andy Bellinger and colored by Jordan Boyd. And the letters are by Sergei LaPointe.
Okay. So if anybody wants to find out more about your books, where should they go? What's the website, the social media, where do we send them?
You can find out everything about our books at tkopresents.com. We are TKO Presents across all socials. So at TKO Presents on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. Come find us. You know, we are really excited to be part of this conversation about what the future of comics holds. And, you know, we are excited to be to have people read our books.
All right. Well, Tze Chun, thanks very much for your time this morning. I appreciate you getting up early to spend some time with us talking about it. Good luck with the new venture.
And thank you very much.
We will have links to TKO in our show notes as well as on our social media once all of this is posted and processed. So that will be our next thing to do a little bit later on in the day.
Okay. All thank right. you.